Hanging out at the End Times Cafe here. All right. Kick back, relax. We're in no hurry here. We won't be arguing and disputing and all that kind of stuff. Having some good humor. Smile on your face. Got some incense going here, some nice incense. So peace to everybody, peace of mind to everybody, bliss to everyone. Bliss is the answer, actually. We just don't think we can get it. So we aim lower, we aim for substitutes for bliss. I say, well, this is kind of like bliss, so it's good enough. That's not good enough. If we can look at bliss and say, why don't we have it? Why don't we don't do sour grapes? Say, it's nothing. Why don't we have it? That's the question. When I see someone like Ramana Maharshi, I say, how come I don't have that? How come we don't have that? Well, why is he so much better than us? What's the deal? How come we don't have it? And let's find out what the problem is. What's our problem? What's our deal? And he says, of course, well, it's just a matter of perseverance. You have to do right effort and perseverance, and then you will have it. So, okay, I believe him. I believe him. So I believe the teachers. Believe in them. Believe the teachers. They're telling the truth. As you pay attention to those who have the bliss, they're telling you true. What they say is something worth listening to, paying attention to, and gradually it gets more and more clear. You can't see the smoke's beautiful. Wow. Gradually, it gets more and more clear. And this is a great example of something. Now, if you were on drugs, you would be paying your attention. You would be looking at the smoke drifting past you, and you become fixated into it, and you go on a trip. Whereas sober, you just say, "Okay, it's beautiful smoke." Okay, boom, right back. Okay, right to the point here. See? Say, okay, it's nice, but this is more important. Talking about bliss is more important. So don't get caught up in your surroundings. Stay focused on why don't we have bliss? Why not? Why not? As you listen to these teachers, it gets clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer. And finally, you just say, of course. What they're saying is like, it's obvious. They're just stating the obvious. And you wonder, how could I ever had trouble seeing this? This is completely obvious. Whereas, when you first they say, "Wow, it's very mystical what they're saying. I can't understand it. It seems conflicted. It seems paradoxical." And then finally, at the end, towards the end, you say, "No, it's completely obvious. How could you not see it that way?" So the work is worth doing. The work, it's worth it. It's worth it. You don't want to be a confused, hopeless mindset. You don't want to continue on with that. You don't want to perpetually be looking at the words of the wise and say, "Oh, this is so confusing. I don't understand it. So arcane, so mysterious, so mystical, so paradoxical. I just have no clue what they're talking about." You don't want that to continue on definitely. So it's a real treat for me to now pay attention to these teachings, and it just I look at them and just say, "Of course. Enough said. Perfect. Right on target. Not a problem at all." They're not trying to fool anyone or trick anyone or speaking in riddles or paradox. No, nothing like that at all. They're just stating what's completely obvious. So the work does pay off in various ways, but again, the ultimate payoff is bliss. So if we don't have that, we have not reached the jackpot. We're still extricating smaller nuggets, but there's one big nugget that is still left to be extricated, which is bliss. Beautiful evening here, a little cool, but all is well, except the anxiety attacks. Some of you may be having anxiety attacks. Boy, really bad. I took a look at something on the internet, and again, it started pulled me into like on Facebook, a bunch of comments, and I don't comment, but my gosh, I'm reading all the comments. I tend to read the comments to take the temperature, to gauge people's minds, and holy cow, it's really enough is enough. It's descended into deplorable conditions, the lack of civil discourse, the lack of two people sitting down and saying, what is important that you and I need to share? What's most important that you and I need to share? That's like gone with the wind. It's just this constant demonizing of one another, just demonizing. We're better than that. We're way, way better than that. And it's deplorable. And it's sad and it's pathetic. And I'm tired of it. I'm really tired of it. Weary of it. I don't want to see my fellow aspects of spirit engaging in such pathetic antics. So it's really, there's really nowhere to turn, almost nowhere to turn in this world right now. Seagram's Key Lime Sparkling Seltzer Water. Hard to find. Been looking for it for about a year. There's like one 12 pack on Amazon for, what was it? $49. It's very good. Just nothing but basically carbonated water. What's in here? Oh, carbonated water, natural flavors. So the deal is now is that the world needs bliss. I'm telling you, the world needs, it's either descend into the abyss or bliss. It's either the abyss or bliss. It's it. That is the truth. There's no more middle ground because there's no more civil discourse. People are incapable of it at this point. Incapable of it. They're simply taking positions. And tribing up, you know, getting into the tribe. And it's us against them. Wow. What about bliss? What about bliss? Carbonation. Bliss or the abyss? Bliss or the abyss? Bliss or the abyss? That is your choice right now. Bliss or the abyss? It's a little scary. People keep thinking, well, it's not the abyss yet. Oh, it is, it is, it is, it is. It's just when you're free falling, it takes a while to realize that it is a free fall. You keep thinking, oh, maybe this is, you know, where's the bottom? And there's no bottom. And you say, wait a minute. It takes a while to sink in, but it's a free fall into the abyss right now. Where heart-centered, love-centered, bliss-centered, truth-centered sharing is gone with the wind. It's an abyss. There seems to be no getting out of it. And at that point, you feel that you need to pull somebody else down to bring yourself up. It's the crab mentality takes over. Instead of saying, let's sit down and let's what's the highest common denominator? Not the lowest. The highest common denominator is bliss. It's our desire for bliss. Now, bliss is not we can say what it's not. We can talk about a whole bunch of things that it's not. It's not anything that we've experienced. Unless we've caught a glimpse of it. Or experience of it for a moment. And when we do, we say, wow, I want that. You know. We say, that's not a new drug. That's that's something else. That's what I really want. Where to go? Where to go? How do I get it back? who's the bliss dealer? Who's dealing in bliss? Then you find the bliss dealer and say, hey, bliss dealer, can you hook me up with some bliss? And they say, sure. Not a problem. You just have to make the right effort and persevere. And you will find it. So it's a good investment of time to invest your time that way, which is what we're doing here. And we're hanging out talking about the highest common denominator. What's the highest common denominator instead of all this lowest common denominator stuff? Not a lot of clarity on bliss. Really is not. There is not at all. I really never come across any. There's a big gap between bliss and not bliss. And the capacity to clarify it, get close to it, is seems to be quite difficult. I've been able to clarify a lot of it for sure. And maybe that's the possibility why I'm having so much anxiety, is I'm saying, wow, I may be getting real close. And that's causes anxiety. Well, it's not maybe. Definitely I'm getting very close. And that's maybe it's nervous time. Maybe it's causing a lot of nerves. Very stressful. Because there's something that is quite something there. And you say, well, is it breakthrough or breakdown? And you say, well, you have to decide, bliss or abyss, breakthrough or breakdown, is again another dichotomy. It is the dialectic of the times. But unlike the Hegelian dialectic, it's one or the other. It doesn't go into some third offshoot, you know. It's not like that. It's an absolute dialectic. So we need bliss. We need those in the world who are sharing bliss and just saying, here's bliss, let's share it. That's it. Here's bliss, let's share that. Let's just sit down and share it. It's being shared, let's share that. Instead of sharing demonization on Facebook and internet forums and at work and at play and all the talk that people are engaged in of demonizing everyone, I say, hey, you know what? Let's just drop that and let's just hang out with bliss. Maybe we'll open up the bliss bar. The Bliss Bar and Cafe, and we'll have some sparkling seltzer water there. Cheers. Why not? I'll open up a virtual Bliss Bar and Cafe online. Join me. Get your seltzer water. John, I don't know, but we need bliss in the world. We need someone who's sharing bliss. Bliss, real bliss, not euphoria, not joy, not happiness, not passion, not intensity, not emotion, not any condition. Euphoria, no. Jubilate, not jubilation. None of that. Now, bliss is simply bliss. It's not something else. It's unconditioned. It's not subject to any conditions. So it's steady. It's steady. There's this incredible steadiness about it, which blows our minds. First time I really came across one who had the bliss, and really saw it, I my mind could not contain it because I said, it's steady, it's impossible. I can see the conditions didn't change it at all. I said, that's, I don't get it. How's that possible? I could see it. It's true, but I couldn't believe what my awareness was aware of. I said, it must be conditioned. How could it be unconditioned? How is that possible? So I was just really flabbergasted. And so when you come across bliss, you are flabbergasted. You just like shake your head and say, holy cow, what in the world? Then the trick is you stay calm. You just say, okay, all right, I'm flabbergasted. Okay, just observe it. Don't get caught up in it. It's like the smoke, the incense passing by, past me here. Constant stream of incense here. And it just, here's the incense. Maybe you can even, it's not trying. Oh, there you go. You can probably see a little bit of smoke. Absolutely. There you go. Don't get flabbergasted by it. Just observe it. Say, okay. Don't start studying the smoke and say, okay, now there's two trails coming off the incense tip, and then as it goes out, it spins this way and that way. Now the wind catches it, and da 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 da. I would just say, okay, there's some incense burning there. Okay, fine. Let it burn. It's okay. Okay, there's bliss. I'm flabbergasted. Okay, let the flabbergast. The shock is be there. I'm shocked. Fine. Okay. That's pretty much what you'd expect because it's. And there's nothing in there. Nature is steady. Especially our minds. So how could there be the steady mind, the steady state of mind? And they don't seem to be having any effort to control it or make it steady. It just is steady. How is that possible? And you say, okay, I have some questions. I'm not really sure how this is possible, but I'm seeing it. It is possible, but I just don't know how. Well, it's okay. All right. And then you might say, is this possible for me? And the bliss says, of course. You say, huh, how come I don't have it? And then, you know, the questioning begins and say, wow, how come I don't have it? But don't get too caught up in the questioning. Keep it simple. You say, I'd like to have this. I don't have it. I'd like to have it. Can I have it? Yeah, say, yeah, it's possible. It's possible. It's not impossible. It's possible. I'm seeing it, so it's possible. So, and then, you know, the doubts arise. You know, there's some doubts arising. And you say, well, it can only happen to them, or it can only happen in some other place, not here. And it can only happen from if you're part of some mystical order or something like that. And you say, well, those are just doubts. Let the doubts arise. Say, okay, don't chase after them. And you say, okay, doubts are arising. Okay, that's fine. All that is not bliss is arising. Okay, that's fine. But that, is bliss bothered by that? No. You look at the one in bliss and they're not bothered by it. So you say, huh, bliss is not concerned about that. Bliss is not concerned about not bliss. Doesn't bother it. Whereas not bliss is bothered by bliss. So, you say, which one's better? It seems like bliss would be better than not bliss. So, what we need to do is in the world, we need bliss, and we need to hang out with bliss. That's it. That is the long and the short of it. And it may be that bliss is saying, hey, temporarily you might need to relocate because this world may be going into maybe going a bit berserk. You can see how wars start. You get a polarization, a demonization of large society as a whole gets all caught up into demonization. They put all their energy there. Then there's no civility left. And then you look across the room and you're looking at your enemy. You're saying, that one, it's impossible to communicate with them. They're incapable of understanding the truth as I see it, you know. And so they're the enemy. They're the ones who are standing in the way of my happiness, my bliss, as it were. So it's important to understand what bliss is so we don't accuse others of standing in our way, standing in the way of bliss, because that's not true. Nobody can stand in the way of bliss. No available bandwidth. Well, so nobody can prevent you from bliss, which is super important to know. So really, you don't have any enemies. You don't really have any enemies. When I look at the world, I don't feel like I have any enemies. There's a lot of challenges out there. A lot of very challenging mindsets. But not to bliss, because bliss is patient. Bliss knows that it's already covered, it's already taken care of. All these mindsets are already taken care of entirely. All mindsets are taken care of. All hypotheticals are already non-judged, eternally non-judged. Everything is already eternally non-judged by the Prime Creator, so it's already all taken care of, everything. So bliss is not concerned about that, which is the amazing thing, is a wonderful thing, is you lose your concern about that. And the fact that people are, you know, Neanderthals doesn't bother you. Or maybe the fact that they're not Neanderthals doesn't bother you, because maybe Neanderthals were wiser than we are. I don't know. It's possible. Certainly it's possible. Maybe the reason why there's no more Neanderthals is because we have devolved, you know, from them. They said, we're not going there. Possible too, right? There's a presumption of progress, which is not necessarily so at all. Because if you lose the capacity to focus on bliss, that's not progress. I think what we've done in the world is we have developed enormous machinery of distraction and then labeled that progress. And flattered ourselves that we're progressive, we're making lots of progress. And it may not be progress at all, maybe regress. Because we're certainly regressing away from the capacity for loving kindness to one another and sharing focus on highest common denominator. We've certainly lost sight of that. Because the highest common denominator is not a worldly issue at all. It's a bliss issue. Why don't we have bliss? It's an issue of ignorance. We're ignoring the fact that all what-ifs are already unjudged, eternally unjudged. We are. Not us. God doesn't judge us at all. I mean, God affirms that we are perfect and flawless, but what-ifs are unjudged. God says, I will never judge what-ifs, ever. I'll never pay any attention to what-ifs, so. All is well. Don't worry. Don't think that is something you're supposed to do. Because if God is paying attention to what is and judging them, then we, as the son of God, will believe that's what we're supposed to do too. We're supposed to judge what ifs and pay attention to them, and that's something is relevant. But God says, no, there's no relevance to it whatsoever. They're all eternally unjudged, and you, as spirit, that's also, it's that way for you too. That's how reality deals with hypotheticals, is simply they're eternally unjudged. And that's bliss. It's symbolized in hypotheticals as bliss. All states of mind are symbolic. In reality, the mind is not in states of mind. It's just, it's mind presenting ideas to spirit, the ideas that are chosen, experiencing, it presents that. It's not in states, but in hypothetical land, we can talk of states of mind. So the final state of mind is bliss, and that too is hypothetical. It's symbolic. But it mirrors the great bliss of reality, as it were. The stateless mind. It mirrors the stateless mind. Natural mind. It mirrors the natural mind. Stateless. So, our chatter here has to revolve around the highest common denominator, what we all really want, which is bliss. We really want to wake up and realize we never left reality. How do we do it? Bliss. It mirrors the great bliss of reality. It's the final state of mind that enables us to set down states of mind, which is set down hypotheticals. Hypothetical is what? It's a what if. What if reality wasn't real? That's a hypothetical. Reality is real. It always will be real. So there's no place in reality for hypotheticals. They don't have any meaning. You can say that they're empty. They're nothing. Just hypotheticals. But we can engage in hypotheticals if we want, but the reaction to a reality to hypotheticals is just eternal non-judgment. They're unjudged. Unjudgment, you can say, unjudged. Everything here is already unjudged. So the stupidest, you know, whatever in the world is just acting out really eccentrically, whimsically, foolish. That's already unjudged. Everything's already unjudged, and that's bliss. That's why you get those in bliss who just bliss shining on to all. And you say, how can you have equal bliss to this fool? And you have equal bliss to this fool, and here's this Mahatma who's very advanced, and you have equal bliss to the fool and the Mahatma. What's going on? Yeah, it's because bliss is all hypotheticals are eternally unjudged. Already everything's covered. That's the nature of bliss. It's all inclusive. It's all inclusive. It's not judging. It's enjoying the eternal unjudgment, unjudgedness, eternal unjudgedness of all hypotheticals. So, what you say? Well, why aren't we reacting? This terrible crisis, or this, you know, horrible event that took place. Everything there is already unjudged. The victim and the victimizer, so to speak, both are unjudged, eternally unjudged, because those are both hypotheticals. What if this could happen? It's not happening in reality. It's only what if it could happen in reality. We're simply simulating a what if it could happen, so that we can stay busy judging. You know what? It's internally unjudged. So every aspect of the situation, existence, is eternally unjudged. That's bliss. So what's the difficulty? I mean, in those, bliss is no difficulty. There's no mental effort. It's not technically judging each thing and trying to say, okay, I forgive this situation because, and trying to figure out, how do I forgive this situation? No, that's not it. It's already, everything is already eternally judged. Concurrent with the beginning of hypotheticals. It was concurrent, the same moment. God said, all hypotheticals are eternally unjudged. Eternally unjudged, all hypotheticals. Regardless of content, of form. Regardless of form. Format, how it's formatted. Somebody's living, somebody's dying. Regardless of any format. All eternally unjudged from the very beginning. So, that's bliss. The awareness of that is bliss. So, as we focus in on bliss, we're getting much, much closer to it, actually. There's no question about it. It's becoming easier and easier and easier for me to focus in on it. So when bliss arises, I say, this is the eternal unjudgment upon all things. Okay, good, 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 good. That's great. That's what I really want. So there'll be a recognition of it. The recognition is not some, I don't feel like I'm going to be thrown into some mystical tailspin or, you know. No, don't feel that way, really. Of course, the world is saying that. Oh, you know, maybe that's the anxiety the world's saying. Oh, look out, look out. You're going to some crazy mystical state. You'll never return. You're going to be like, blah, blah. No, that's not like, I don't, that's not the true at all. It's just you recognize the situation. Okay, this is, I'm accepting the obvious response of the prime creator to hypotheticals, which is concurrent, eternally unjudged. All hypotheticals are eternally unjudged. So, just experiencing that, and that experience is this steady state, peace of mind, beyond understanding, which is what we call bliss. So, piece of cake. It's the world that is worried. So, I may be still paying attention to the anxiety of the world about this. Because I shouldn't be anxious. So it must be the mindset of the world that is I'm still engaged with that is causing this anxiety for me. As if, you know, they're saying, well, we can never get that. We can never. Of course you can. How difficult can it possibly be? Just as easy to explain it. Just hypotheticals. Unjudged, eternally unjudged. They have no effect on reality. There's no reason to pay any attention to them whatsoever. It's not difficult. What happens is we're so used to, out of compassion, we want to help people, so we pull in their mindsets to us. And we feel we need to engage with these mindsets, which is really terror, fear of God. And so we can only take those mindsets so far, because they start causing us a lot of anxiety. As we get closer to bliss, they just have all this terror in them, which is simply based on ignorance. They're not looking, they're just assuming. They're assuming that bliss is some kind of mental annihilation or something like that. You know, there's all these crazy assumptions that are not based on reason at all. It's based on whim. So of course whim cannot approach bliss without fear. Because whim is a completely totally unsteady. And it sees itself as reality. And so as it comes close to a steady state, a steady mind, steady condition, it sees that as its annihilation. That it will not be able to communicate or comprehend it or relate to it in any way. And that it feels that there's going to be conflict, or it just wants to flee, wants to get away from it. It says, this isn't my cup of tea at all. So, certainly, you cannot bring whim to bliss. You cannot. Fortunately, we don't need to, because whim is not a state of its own. It's only wishful thinking. It's hypothetical on our part. So we don't need to believe that there's some hypothetical that's separate from us, that we need to bring that into the fold. No, that's not true. Hypotheticals are themselves whimsical. Very active of choosing what if is active whimsy. Absolutely. But bliss doesn't get rid of hypotheticals. It just says, this one isn't eternally unjudged, and this is eternally unjudged. Everything's eternally unjudged. It doesn't say disappear everything. It's not like the universe disappears. We're not trying to make the universe disappear. No, the universe remains. Everything remains. As it is, except now we say, I'm experiencing that it's all eternally unjudged. And so then as a delight, say, this too is eternally unjudged, and this one over here is eternally unjudged too. Wonderful. Very happy then. So that's how the world gets transformed into a happy place. You've heard gurus talk about that, and you wonder, what in the world are they talking about? Because they don't seem to explain. They have, sometimes seem to have trouble explaining it for some reason. I don't know why, but that's easy to explain. They're simply seeing that it's all unjudged, eternally unjudged. It's like, wonderful. Oh, I'm so happy that this is not an obstacle to my peace. This too is not an obstacle to peace. It never was. It never was. How wonderful. And then we look at our imagining and say, hey, you know, our imaginings were really creative and really beautiful. And thank God that God didn't judge any of them. They're all unjudged. Equally unjudged. And then there's then appreciation of all our imaginings comes as far as our the capacity of the mind to imagine all this, which is pretty amazing. You know, I have dreams that I wake up and I just can't get over how incredible they are. It's just mind-blowing because the detail in the dreams, incredible detail. And I'm seeing stuff I've never seen in the world before. I mean, it's just the creativity of the dreams. My God. Stupendous. And the action of all the actors and the expressions, everything down to the most incredible high definition detail of everything is just amazing. I can't say, how is that possible? Where did that even come from? I never even thought about anything that like that. And this mind is producing this movie while I sleep that is just stupendous movies, you know, just stupendous stuff. As far as production value, the production value is completely off the charts. That's the mind. But so when we accept that it's all eternally unjudged, then we can just enjoy the play of mind here in hypothetical land. It's still there's richness to it. There's richness to it. So now don't have to make the universe disappear at all. You don't have to make anything disappear. You don't have to make the mind disappear. You don't have to attack anything. You don't have to apply the bliss to get rid of the ego or the mind or get rid of anything at all. No, everything remains. You don't want to get rid of anything. So this is... what kind of bug is that? I don't know. Speaking of bugs, there are a lot of different bugs in the world. It's amazing, isn't it? The richness of all the hypotheticals we've imagined. Like, what if there were bugs? And what if there were trees? What if there were this? What if there were that? What if the trees grew and then they died? And so there's all this incredible, rich imagination that the mind has been engaging in because we told it to. We said we want to be prime creators, so you got to imagine there's a way to do that. We can then appreciate it to some extent. There's a certain appreciation of it. And everything is appreciated. Wherever you are, everything's appreciated. So, it's not so mystical. It is not something that's uncaused. It's not something that we cannot approach through our reason. It's not something that we can't look at. It's not something that we can't talk about. Absolutely, we can't. We just don't try. The world doesn't try. So there's like an inherent assumption. It's a tacit assumption that arises from inaction, that we tacitly assume that it's not possible since we're not trying to do it. This is the danger of the times we live in. It's a very dangerous time we live in. It might even be too dangerous for me, for any of us, really. Is that bug moving? I think there's, let me see. It's a little ant. It's a little ant. And the little ant is trying to crawl across the keyboard. Okay. There's this tacit assumption that we're not trying, so it must not be possible. Whew. Dangerous situation. We don't realize it. See, we don't realize the implicit assumptions that arise from automatically in our mind. We don't catch them. By simply nobody, nothing really going on as far as focusing here on bliss like this, we assume it's not possible. We assume can't be possible. If it were possible, we'd be doing it. That's the subtle insanity we're engaged in. If it's possible, we would be doing it. But we're not. Because why? We're making a greater effort to distract ourselves. We underestimate our capacity to distract ourselves. We underestimate it. We're not honest about it. We're not honest. Like, that's one thing I can see in the world, is the distraction to me is obvious. And when you try to bring it up to people, they say, oh, no. They're not willing to admit to it. So they're dishonest in that way. So being dishonest in that way leads to this severe problem of assuming that approaching bliss like this isn't possible, and therefore bliss itself is not possible. So there's no point even then making the effort. See, it's a circular situation. But if you come across situations like this, you can say, hey, it is possible. And that breaks this circular downward spiral. You say, wait a minute, it is possible. Why am I not doing it? I'm being distracted. Am I distracting myself? Yeah, I am. How am I distracted? Let me see. Okay, let me see if I can not distract myself and get to it. You know, let me pry myself away from Facebook and let's pay attention to this. And then you become honest, and then you have a spiritual path. Spiritual path can't begin until there's some self-honesty, saying, wait a minute, what am I, is it true it's impossible? No. Is bliss possible? Yes. Can you approach it? Yes. I'm not doing it. Why? I must be distracting myself. I must be distracting, engaging in distraction too much. And then you have to struggle against the current, which the current is just those who say, ah, no, it's not possible, because if it were, we'd be doing it. Because we're not really trying to distract ourselves. We're only, what they say is, we're only distracting ourselves because it's not possible. So what else do you expect us to do? It's upside down and backwards. It's, we're not doing it because so much effort to distract ourselves. It's not that we're only distracting ourselves because it's not possible. That's backwards. But that's how the world has it. They don't even try. They say it's ridiculous. Why try to do something that's impossible? Well, trying to become prime creator is attempt to become, is an attempt at impossibility, which is what everybody's doing. So they have it backwards. They see what is possible as impossible, and what's impossible as possible. And that's a pretty deep hole to be in. Don't want to stay in that hole, I'll tell you that, that's for sure. What happened to, you know, in the world, we are family. We are family. All my sisters, brothers, and me. So whatever happened to we are family? People say, you know, we're all one family. We're just all one family here. Let's find the highest common denominator here. Wow. You know, these times are really, I'm sick and tired of these times, very much so. It's bliss time. It's bliss time, really. Enough of time. Time does not use itself wisely. You might say that time is a waste of time. Only the Holy Spirit knows how to use time wisely, because it uses it to lead you to bliss. Again, what is bliss? Have we forgotten? It is recognition of the eternal unjudgment of all hypotheticals, which means everything in existence. It's all existence is hypothetical. Whatever is impermanent is a hypothetical. The play of impermanence is the play of hypotheticalness. The dance of Maya is the dance of hypotheticalness. Dance of constructivity, destructivity, construction, preservation, destruction, that's the dance of hypotheticalness. It's not the dance of God, it's the dance of the Son of God. It's, Prime Creator is not doing this dance. That's why you have Parabrahman and Brahman, the great God, the true great God, and then Brahman is, in Christianity, is God the Father, God the Son. And then you have God the Holy Spirit, which is the one that helps God the Son to bliss first, and then to dropping all hypotheticals. It's not mysterious at all. No mystery to it. There's no reason to create an aura of awe about it at all, mysticism or awe or anything like that. That's why Krishnamurti tried to say, hey, I don't like this, all this mysticism and awe and all this stuff. That's just simply not where it's at. He said, let's sit here together and share our highest clarity here. Which he came over to the West and says, hey, he didn't like the awe and mysticism and all that stuff of the East. And so he said, I'm going to come over to the West. They seem to be more rushed and they like all that stuff. But he found out that they were a little bit overdoing that in, you know, too materialistic and too much throwing out the baby with the bathwater. So six of one, half a dozen of the other, really. But that's what Krishnamurti did. He's just brought people together and said, let's just sit here and share the highest clarity, highest purpose, what we really want. Let's talk about what we really want here, folks. Leave your dumb phones out of it. Leave all that stuff. Leave all your apps and the dumb phone and its apps and your politics and your social issues. And let's leave all that stuff. Put it all, like taking off your shoes. Take those shoes off. Leave them outside the door. Let's come in here. Let's talk about what we really want. Let's focus on what we really want. What we really want is bliss. And we've been conditioned through this trick of mind to believe it's not possible simply because we are not trying to do it. And we are flattering ourselves by saying, if we could do it, we would have already been trying to do it. And since we're not trying to do it, that automatically means it's not possible. That is self-deceit. Because we're leaving out the part of that we're attempting to be prime creator. See, we're leaving that part out. And say we can't accept bliss and try to be prime creator at the same time. So what the people are really saying is, we would rather try to become prime creator than to accept the fact that we are one with the prime creator already, as the Son of God Spirit. That's what they're really saying. But they're unaware of that too. It's become all confused. And of course, confusion itself is a great defense, isn't it? You can always claim confusion. But out of claiming confusion comes the, again, tacit, implicit assumptions that sanity is not possible. Because if it were, certain confusion would be trying to reach it. Confusion is confusion. It's a choice. So who's doing the choosing is the question. There's one that's doing the choosing has to say, hey, even in, like, when I experienced total mental chaos, there was still one there who was observing it, saying, okay, this is total mental chaos. Very sane. That one wasn't in chaos, or that one was still completely calm and sane and just looking at it and saying, okay, that's total mental chaos. Okay, I don't want that. Or the mind just ricocheted back from it. Okay, the mind cannot stay in that condition. Just observing it. So I said, who's that? Who's that one? You know, let's find out who that one is. That must be the one that is, perhaps that's the one that's choosing it. Maybe there's some chooser of all this. One who is who's trying to deceive themselves. Maybe there's one that's trying to deceive themselves. I actually saw that. We're trying to deceive ourselves. So when we see that, we say, okay, it's not that, it's that we're choosing confusion. And we can also choose bliss. Just the fact that we are choosing confusion doesn't mean that bliss is impossible for us, that we can't choose it. Confusion is our way of trying to convince ourselves that we can't choose bliss. That's impossible for us. It's our way of trying to tell us that what is possible is impossible. That's what confusion really is. That's what chaos, mental chaos, is saying, that it's impossible to choose what is possible, which is bliss. It's impossible to choose that. But then you realize that you say, no, it's not impossible. That's what I experienced, because the message of that total mental chaos was, you cannot, you're completely incompetent. You're totally, 100% eternally incompetent. That was the message that was being delivered. And I said, no, I'm not, because I just judged that I don't like this state, which is a very sane judgment. You see, so how could I be incompetent? So immediately I rejected it, and the spiritual path began full blast at that point, because I said, hey, something's trying to convince me that I'm eternally incompetent, and it's impossible for me to be ever be competent, and I just rejected that, so I can't possibly be incompetent. So, wow, there's something that's really against me, you know, some kind of adversary that's trying to convince me of something entirely malicious. Well, where was that coming from? And then the spiritual path unfolds and you gradually put it all in perspective. And we don't need to judge the... Bliss isn't judging. Of course, Bliss is aware that people here are trying to convince themselves that they can't possibly reach Bliss, but Bliss knows that's not true, but it's aware. It's aware. It's not stupid. It's aware. And it's aware that people need a Bliss hug, so to speak. Not a physical hug, but a sharing of Bliss that they can just, not judging their stupidity, you know, that, but what they want, need is to take those shoes off, the shoes of stupidity, the shoes of eccentric whims, and take them off and just forget about it, you know. Just say, well, I was just trying to convince myself I was incompetent, but I wasn't able to. Congratulations. Nobody's able to. Some try harder than others, all different ways. But it all ends up failure, same failure. It's impossible we can't convince truth that it's not true. You see, it's impossible. But it's a tough sell. But it can be done. It's a tough sell because everybody is still caught up in the dualism of the way that I can feel good is that I can point somebody else out that's wrong. that I'm good because they're wrong. That's not Bliss. What Bliss comes from saying, I feel wonderful because everything I see, I'm aware that it's eternally unjudged. It's a different thing. Everything is eternally unjudged. Unjudged. Not you are bad and that makes me feel better about myself, like you are wrong, so I feel better about my position. No, that's dualism. Everyone's still caught up in that. They're still caught up. Everybody. Almost everybody on the planet is still in the clutches of dualism. Big time. And try as they might, again, that implicit assumption that they can't do it. They can't, somehow Bliss is going to escape them. They're not able to, they're incompetent. They're incompetent. What I found out was the ego played its ace on me and it failed. I had a trump card, I had a joker in the deck. And so the game, the jig was up for the ego because the ego played its total mental chaos. It played its final card. That's it. And I said, wait a minute. I don't like this. I don't want this. And the ego said, I'm totally incompetent. I said, no, I'm not. I just said, I don't like this. And that's a very wise decision. I'm not incompetent. So at that point, the ego game was up for me. The game was up. I knew it. I just knew it was going to take some time to sort through all this stuff and accept the fact that that's it. But so for others, they're worried about that they might be incompetent, you see. So they say, well, I don't want to risk it. So if I don't want to try to do something that it might reveal my incompetence, you see. So I saw that even in total mental chaos, complete chaos with no capacity to do anything about it, because it was completely chaotic. There was no center, order, to anything. No laws, no order, nothing. Utter chaos. I still said, hey, you know what? I don't like this. I'm sure I don't like it. I don't want this. I said, that's very sane. So I realized then that this is as far as you can go, as far as incompetence goes. And even then, I was competent. So broke this, the strength of the ego, broke its hold on me then. Whereas what I see in the world, most people in the world, they still worry, like, wow, I know the ego's got some, and I may end up finding out that I'm completely incompetent, completely stupid, completely ugly, completely terrible, eternally damned. Okay, but so when I experienced that ego claiming I was eternally damned, I said, well, you know what, I don't like this. This is not me. This is not what I really want. And I said, ego, you're wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong. And you always will be wrong. That's a mistake. You blew it. Game's up. And so then at that point, I said, I know I can reach bliss. There's no question about it. I'm not incompetent. I know that I'm not incompetent. Therefore, I'm capable. And what I'm capable of getting what I really want. I got some inherent incompetence in me. I knew it. And from that point on, then I started losing my fear of going after bliss bit by bit by bit. Because, of course, you don't want to. There's a lingering fear like I might be incompetent. You know, there's like sort of the echoes of that are still there, maybe. That's why I'm feeling some anxiety. Echoes. But for most people, they say, whoa. I don't want to go for the big pattern of bliss because I might find out that I can't do it, and I'll find out I'm eternally incompetent. I don't want to experience that, so I'll just settle for something less. That's the problem. That's really the problem. It seems like a unsolvable problem, because the only way to really solve it is to find out, to bottom out, and find out that you're not incompetent. So I feel the world is probably headed towards bottoming out. That's how I see it. Not a bad thing at all. Because when it bottoms out, everyone will still realize that, you know what, we're not incompetent. Even this whole planet, you know, just completely wrecked, and but yet we're not incompetent. We're not. We don't want this. We don't want this. And then right there, you say, hey, wait a minute, we're not incompetent. We don't want this. We really don't want this. We're never going to want this. That's what I realized. I'm never going to want this. State of total chaos. And I realized the mind will never accept it. The mind cannot accept that. It can only, for an instant, make it, what if the mind could have eternal chaos and symbolize it, but only for an instant. No, I don't want that. I cannot, that's not what I am. So the mind could not maintain that. Mind didn't want it. I observed it. I said, the mind cannot be in total chaos. Other than just for hypothetically imagining if it were possible. But the mind doesn't want it. I don't want it. So there's competence. So bottoming out is when you discover that you're not incompetent. You never can be incompetent. It's impossible. And then you turn the tables on the ego and say, wait a minute, ego, you're trying to get me to do the impossible. It's bliss that's possible. Is the eternally denying it that's impossible. You see? So, the world bottoming out is not a bad thing. Not a bad thing at all. It's really probably just the medicine everybody needs. It's better, probably, to do it on your own. Like, I went through it. I was able to then have the path that I've had. I don't know what it's going to be like when the world goes through it collectively. How that's going to work out, I really don't know. Haven't quite focused on that yet. What's that going to be like? Because there's really not a... I would assume what would happen is that people who've bottomed out will automatically gravitate towards an ashram-like situation. Where they say, hey, you know what? I'm not incompetent, so I can do it. Let's do it. Let's get after this. So it's probably what will happen, I would think. Because at that point, you're not interested in civilization anymore. You're interested in bliss. Guaranteed. Because when you discover that you are absolutely not incompetent, then you say, hey, I can get what I really want. I don't have to be worried about failure. I'm not going to fail. It's impossible. I can't fail. So then you say, I want bliss. I want to wake up. I want to drop hypotheticals. The continuity problem is solved through bliss. I want that. And so you automatically gravitate to that, automatically. So people will automatically gravitate to spiritual teachings and spiritual teachers. But it may be a very diverse kind of situation. There may be, so it civilization crumbles. It may not be a situation where the effort is to build up some other great civilization. That won't happen. That won't happen. At least for those who have bottomed out. No. That's why I say the relocation, death-free realms, that kind of situation. It's like an ashramic situation. It's a retreat situation where you go into these various retreats and ashrams and places of spiritual inquiry and focus, and you're not concerned about building up some great civilization, some great culture, all this stuff. You're not concerned about that at all. You're saying, hey, I want bliss. That's what I want, because I know I'm not incompetent. I'll never be incompetent. So why am I wasting my time chasing after crumbs? Only people who have fear of incompetence do that. So people might be wondering, how in the world can I talk like this? Who does he think he is? Well, the thing is, I lost my fear of incompetence when I found out that it's impossible. I can't be incompetent. Totally impossible. So obviously then at that point I said, hey, why should I settle for crumbs? That's why be a beggar? That's the hallmark of those who fear that they might be incompetent. But I said, I know I'm not. So I'm going for, you know, the prize. And it's not an arrogant thing. It's just based on the realization that I'm not incompetent and never can be. Even in the face of complete chaos, I realize I'm not incompetent. So for those who haven't realized that, they see that it's like reaching too high. They say, oh, you're overreaching. Who in the world are you who say you can be like Ramana Maharshi, you can have the same bliss? You're way overreaching. You're going to find out that you're going to fail. You're going to find out you're incompetent. That's their fear. And they're trying to hold. They think that they're helping you by holding you back, saying, whoa. Yeah, you're going to find out you're totally incompetent. You can't handle it. I said, what do you mean? How difficult is it to handle simply seeing that everything is eternally unjudged? That's not, how can that be difficult? It's not difficult. But that's where they're coming from. That is where their fear is coming from. They think they're doing you a favor by holding you back, putting obstacles in your way. And then, of course, those who do accept bliss, the eternal unjudgment upon all hypotheticals, then the people who fear incompetence want to worship them, say, oh, you're some incredible incarnation of God. You're so great. And they distance themselves. Say, you're so awesome. There's no way we could do that, but you're special. You're special. No, see, that's not true. That's why Anandamayi Ma always very adamantly insisted she was not the mother. She said, if you're going to see me as a person at all, you see me as a little girl. That's it. I'm just a little girl who never grew up. I'm not the mother. But she says, really, you don't have to see me as a person at all. Just see me as the bliss that I am. But if you must personify me as a little girl, which of course you're not going to worship, okay? Because she said, worshiping and saying that you're the mother of great is a form of distancing. Awe is a form of distancing. It's basically saying that people are saying that they're incompetent, that they have a fundamental incompetence. There's no way they can do what is that they're seeing here, and that there's some fundamental, existential, fundamental gap there that can never be filled. So all we can do is just worship this being, and that's it. That's not true. So she was very adamant about that, and people still, you know, worshipped her as the mother. But she said, no, I'm seeing me as a little girl, or your sister, or a friend, but better just a little child who never grew up. Little child who never grew up. So that's saying, hey, you're competent. You got to recognize that you are competent. So a lot of people who have drug addictions and all sorts of addictions, they tend to bottom out in one way or the other. But you don't really bottom out until you experience a moment of this mental chaos. When you experience that, you bottomed out, and then you realize you don't want it, and then game's up for the ego. Game's up. You realize you're going to get free. See, I knew it back in 1978. I knew beyond any doubt. I said, I know I'm going to get free. It's totally certain of it. I just didn't know when. I didn't know how long it would take. I really didn't have any idea how long it would take. Still don't. But I know I'm going to get free at that point. And so that's why usually the people on the spiritual path have had a lot of severe problems in their past. Usually. Not always, but that's very common. But they've led a really difficult life. Their life has just been wow. You know, just been put through the ringer. Because the ego keeps trying to prove that they're incompetent. So you're incompetent. They want the bliss. And the ego says, ah, how can you have bliss? Look, you can't even handle this problem. How can you handle bliss? You can't even handle this suffering. How can you handle bliss? You're incompetent. You're too stupid for that. And so their lives, they end up in, you know, big trouble. And finally end up in states of mental confusion. Severe confusion, and bottom out that way. So the world is going as fast as possible towards bottoming out, which is not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing, really. Again, something that has to be gone through. So that you can get the baseline of realizing you're not, no matter what, you're not incompetent. No matter what, you're not. It's impossible for you to be incompetent. Therefore, and then you start saying, hey, who is it that says I can't have bliss? Who's saying that? Who's saying I'm incompetent? No, I'm not. I can choose between what I want and what I don't want. That's competence. So I say bliss is what I want and non-bliss is what I don't want. So I'm competent to do that. So the world is just having all these pissing contests, you know, it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. It's like adolescence. Really, the world is behaving in extraordinarily adolescent ways. But it's headed quickly for a big dust up. And then after that, you will find out an amazing thing. Amazing transformation. As people say, holy cow. I'm not incompetent. I want bliss. Let's go for it. And then, boom, that's the spiritual path. And they start paying attention to teachers and what they have to say. So, all is not lost. All is not lost, that is for sure. It's just, it's really no fun watching what's going on, though, in the world. We can't get to the bottoming out time fast enough, so then we can, people will start, will recognize their inherent competence. Right now, everybody is pointing fingers and saying, you're incompetent. And the other one says, no, you are. No, you are. No, you are. That's all that's going on. Everybody's saying, you're the one who's incompetent. I'm not incompetent because you're the one who's incompetent. The whole world's basically saying, we know someone's incompetent, but who? It's not us, it's them. They're the ones. So it's just projecting this fear of incompetence onto others. Back and forth. Name calling, silly adolescent stuff. It's puerile, you know. It's no fun. It's no fun to see. For me to see that it's not funny. It's not fun. And it's tiresome. So I don't want to hang around and watch that. What I'm looking forward to is once the bottoming out occurs, then those same people who are having these pissing contests now will say, hey, guess what? I found out nobody's incompetent. It's impossible to be incompetent. Nobody's incompetent. And therefore, why waste time in this foolishness? Let me go for what I really want. And then they say, hey, I really want Bliss. There's Bliss. Wow, that's great. Then that'll be good times, great times then. Great times, no more adolescence, the end of adolescence. See, the end of adolescence. Adolescence is when you're not sure if you're competent or not. You think your competence may be taken away from you. So you're demonizing someone else. Say, no, they're the ones. They're the ones who are incompetent. What I discovered is that everyone's competent. It's impossible to be incompetent. Impossible for the mind to be incompetent. Impossible for spirit to be incompetent. So everyone's competent. So I know everyone will be enlightened. Everyone will choose Bliss. No question about it. Totally impossible that it be otherwise. So for me, all this time people projecting who's incompetent or not is just a total waste of time. Nobody's incompetent. That's the answer. Nobody's incompetent. So why are we wasting our time having these pissing contests? And it's ridiculous. But it comes from the insecurity, the fear that maybe we are. Maybe there's this some experience we have which will point it out to us. And the ego's got that ace up its sleeve, and it says, I'm going to play this. If you don't project your fear of incompetence onto some enemy and attack them and defend against them, then I'm going to play this card on you. And so you say, okay, those guys over there are the bad guys. They're the bad guys. They're the polarization in society is this side of this issue, they're the incompetence. And the ego says, yeah, that's right, you see? Now you're competent, you see? Because they're incompetent. It's not you, it's them. So what you're agreeing upon, you're agreeing with the ego that there is such a thing as the Son of God being incompetent. You're agreeing with the ego there. It's just not you, it's them. Which then, of course, agreeing with fragmentation, which means we're not all one. How can we be all one if one is competent, the other is incompetent? Different, right? So you're agreeing with the ego that reality is not real. It's fragmented. It's not all one. It's fragmented. So, you see, it's a very, very consequential situation to this polarization, this duality. It's very consequential as far as your own confusion goes. Very consequential. So as you're projecting on someone else, saying they're the ones that are incompetent, you are agreeing with the insanity of that reality can be changed, that hypotheticals can be real, and all the stuff that comes with that, which ultimately means you think you're incompetent because you're stuck in hypothetical land. So all this projection is terrible, terrible, terrible thing to witness, to see this. It's like, wow, folks, can we not just all get along? Obviously not. See, because the ego is threatening everybody with total chaos and unless they project and insist the incompetence is out there. And they think they are escaping their own incompetence by doing that. But see, what I discovered is that nobody's incompetent. It's impossible. So there's no reason for all this projection and stuff. It's just a complete waste of time. So, but of course, I'm very bored by hanging out in this world where everybody is projecting incompetence on everyone else. It's just a complete waste of time. I mean, I have nothing to do. Why should I hang out here? It's ridiculous. The world bores me to tears. I can't find anything here. I'm not interested in these ridiculous situations, because I realize it's just a complete waste of time, utter and complete waste of time, and it's actually driving people into deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper confusion. But the end game would be that some will bottom out, which again is not a bad thing at all. That's the beginning of the end for the ego. In fact, when you bottom out, that is the end of the ego, essentially. For all practical purposes, it is the end. It's just that you have to come to accept that. You have to accept, hey, I really Everything really is okay. Everything's perfect. No problem. I don't have any problems. So it takes a while to realize you don't have any problems. Nobody has any problems. Nobody's incompetent. It takes a while to just accept it and say, okay. You know that when the funny men, the comedians, they when they lose it and they get into these pissing contests, and you know things must be really bad. They can't even laugh at, they can't even laugh at themselves anymore. they take themselves seriously now. You see, the court jester taking themselves seriously, then you know you've got a problem. No more court jesters. No more court jesters in the world. Then you know, look out. Look out. Big dust up coming. Anyway, yeah. When you have people saying, our court jester is better than your court jester. Your court jester is incompetent. Our court jester is competent. The other group says, no, no, your court jester is terrible, incompetent. Ours is competent. Whew, you know, we can't. Comedy is not a common denominator. It's not the highest common denominator at all. And those who placed their hopes on that are now finding out that they're up a creek. Instead of comedy, try Krishnamurti, something like that, you know, instead of that. And try satsang instead of comedy. Comedy is just a way of saying, hey, folks, we know here, we know we're competent, but those over there, they're not. They're so silly. Let's have a good laugh at their expense, you know. And it's just kind of like that, really. So it's really just a sort of self-deceiving way of projecting incompetence over there. That's all it really is. And there's really nothing funny about that, because, again, in doing that, you're siding with the basic premises of insanity, that Son of God can be incompetent, therefore, and you're not, and therefore there's a division in reality, there's a separation, fragmentation, and all this stuff, which is simply hypothetical. So you start believing hypotheticals are real, and then you're in big trouble. Not real trouble, because you're competent. But the slide, you know, you're going down into the abyss for sure. Good news is there is a bottom to the abyss. There is a bottom to it. So, and you realize that even at the bottom, you're competent. You say, hey, I don't like this place. I don't like being on the bottom here. I don't like this. And you say, hey, I'm pretty smart. Yeah, I'm smart enough to see that. I'll tell you that. Now, who is this idiot that telling me I'm incapable of realizing I don't like this? Who's telling me that? What's telling me that? I gotta look into this, because there's a nutcase who's giving me this bad advice. And then you start tracking it down like a tracker. You track down that spiritual path, you track it down, and you find out. And the teachers, they know they can help you track it down. Holy Spirit knows perfectly well. He'll help you track it down, help you clarify it, help you understand it. So, but what's to come in the world? Oh boy, I don't know. Probably best to get out of Dodge. A lot of big pissing contests are coming. That's what's coming. The pissing contests are going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. Pretty soon the pissing contests will include big guns and big weapons and, you know, all this kind of stuff. That's how war is just a big pissing contest, you know. That's just what it is. And we always say, well, it's the men that are doing that. No, it's the men driven by the women that are doing it. Women are frantically invested in that right now. But, you know, they get the men to do the dirty work, get the men to get blown to pieces. Because men can't have babies, so, you know, they're expendable. just a practical situation. You want to keep the pissing contest going indefinitely. You need to have more more people in the world. Have to keep having bodies. So you got to protect the women from the dirty work. So the more bodies can be brought into the world. So this foolishness can continue. Of course, when you're on the front lines, it's easier to see, hey, this all sucks, the bottom out. A lot of men have bottomed out from war, and they just realize, hey, I just bottomed out, and it's just total chaos. Everything around me just slaughtered everywhere. And all my, you know, all my friends and comrades and everybody else, I'd look on the battlefield, and everybody's slaughtered, and they just say, you know what? I don't care they're all dead, and they're all slaughtered, and they bottom out. They bottom out. So there's a tendency in the world, historically speaking, that more men have bottomed out than women. Because they doing the dirty work, you tend to bottom out. There's more of opportunity to bottom out doing that really terrible, terrible stuff. So, and then bottoming out, then they just say, hey, forget about this, man. I can see, I don't want this. This isn't it. I'm competent to judge that. Forget it. No way. No mas. So maybe with more women in combat, more women will bottom out too. That's possible. They may just say, wow, forget it. But the queen bees back home that are instigating everything, you know, they generally don't bottom out, but this time they might, as a matter of fact, which is good for them. Maybe very good for them. They're the last ones to bottom. The queen bees are the last ones to bottom out, because they're the ones who are most expert at manipulating others to get others to do the dirty work and defend them. It's like the queen of a hive gets everyone else to defend the queen, right? So the principle of defending fertility, it holds out the longest, gets everyone else to do the dirty work and bottom out first. So the queen can keep on producing more cannon fodder, more bodies, more suits. And but when things get really bad, which they may very well this time, even the queen bees get caught up in it and bottom out, which is good for them. It's good for them. That'd be great for them. But they'll be sure to feed everyone to the fire first. That is for sure. But they may just feed everybody the fire and find out the fire is still there. And there's nobody else to feed to the fire. And then they'll go through it themselves. And then they'll realize that they're not really incompetent either. So they don't need to be playing this stupid game anymore of projecting incompetence on everybody else. And intimidating everybody that way. And saying, look, I can produce bodies. And you can't, so you must be more incompetent than me. That's always a trump card, seemingly, in this world. As if bodies were life. Bodies aren't life, they're death. They're nothing. They're nothing, just meat suits. So producing bodies doesn't mean anything. It's not a sign of competence at all. Competence is inherent within life, within true life. Life can say, hey, I want life. I love life. I don't like death. I don't like bodies. I don't like chaos. I don't like that. I don't want it. That's competence. Life saying, no, it's just a dream. I don't like this dream. So maybe this equal opportunity, equality in the world, is everyone's going to get bottomed out. Which is a great thing, great thing. Great thing, really, in the big picture, it's a great thing. Great thing to discover your competence, that it cannot be eradicated. Cannot. when the queen bee realized there's nobody else around to worship me as queen bee, nothing, nobody, then they say, oh my God, claps into total chaos, and then they realize, hey, I don't like this total chaos, this is not me, I don't like this, I don't want it, and then they say, hey, I got no fear anymore, bliss, I don't have to fear bliss, I can choose bliss instead of this ridiculous charade as being the queen bee, mother of nothing, really, of hypotheticals. Who wants to be the god of hypotheticals, or the goddess, the queen of hypotheticals? Who wants to be that? Nobody. Nobody. Just an idol anyway. We don't need those idols. And they can say, hey, I don't need to this idol anymore. I don't need to identify with this idol of fertility and bodies and all that. Don't need it. Don't need it. I can get bliss because I'm competent. I'm competent. I know I'm competent. The ego cannot frighten me anymore. So, one way or another, that happens for everyone. You keep going through incarnation, until you finally bottom out. It's what happens. You finally discover that you're not incompetent. It's impossible that you're incompetent. You finally discover it. So, teachers will certainly be available for those. The Holy Spirit's always available. And those who help the Holy Spirit are always available. Will be available. There will be those. And when you bottom out, you'll get help for sure. Just like I got help. I got super help. Because the Holy Spirit said, hey, this one has bottomed out. And he's good to go. Here you go. And the Holy Spirit knew. Holy Spirit knew for sure. He said, nah. This one bottomed out, got the recognition, it's there, go time. And then I got super teaching from super teachers. That's exactly what will happen with you. You right now you don't think you deserve it, but once you bottom out, you'll know you deserve it. I said, I know I deserve the best teaching possible. I know I deserve it. I know I deserve competent teachers, because I know I'm competent, so I deserve competent teachers. And so I got competent teachers. And of course the Holy Spirit's, you know, totally competent, and they're always there in ways that we don't, hard to recognize, really. Like today I was saying, like, Holy Spirit, I haven't seen you for a long time. You haven't helped me in a long, long time. Because it works in subtle ways. Sometimes. But it's there, and it's helping clarify, which it's doing right now. So, it's, what time is it tonight? It's 11 o'clock. About time to close the Bliss Bar and Cafe down. Last call. And, if you haven't bottomed out yet, all this can be helpful. Because before I bottomed out, I certainly studied so much spiritual stuff, because I must have known ahead of time I was getting ready to bottom out. There must have been something in me and realize I'm going to bottom out. So I studied so much, so that I was able to bottom out. And then I said, you know, no, I had a sort of familiarity with spiritual teachings and path. And I said, no, you know, this is doable. So anyway, tomorrow's another day, and yet the world is, oh boy, these are the times, no question about it, 100% for sure, these are the times that things get out of hand. Don't fear the times, don't fear it. For me, I just don't really want to pay attention to them. It's just no fun at all. But as far as your fear of incompetence, no way. No way. You will discover that you're competent. See, once I discovered it, I was different. And I couldn't relate to people anymore, really, in the world. I felt there's a fundamental difference between me and others. And from a pragmatic standpoint, there is a fundamental difference. So I know I can do it. I know I'm competent. I know I can reach bliss. I know I'm going to be enlightened. I'm positive of it. Whereas other people, no, they don't have that assurance. So they think my self-assurance is too much, off the charts. And so therefore they don't want to really associate with someone they may feel is got some kind of inflated, you know, opinion of themselves or something. And I just realized that I'm different now because others don't share my confidence. So it is kind of a lonely path that way. You just can't find people to share your confidence. And that's not fun. That's not fun at all. It's difficult, for sure. But coming up, there'll be probably a lot of people who have confidence that they're not incompetent. A lot of people, a lot more. In my situation, people were not so many like that. Doing it kind of ahead of a time. So be available to help out others when the situation arises. Now, as I will, I'll be a teacher in the near future, no doubt, and be able to help others on the spiritual path at that point once they bottom out. So it is necessary for some people to kind of, you know, go up ahead of time and push things. And it's pretty lonely and very isolated and lonely situation, actually. But it was necessary, so I can be of service. Once a lot of people start bottoming out, there's going to be a demand, big demand for teachers, big demand. That's why Ramana told me, in a vision, dream vision, once he said, "Look, you see everybody following me?" I said, "Yeah, you've got a lot of people are paying attention to you." And he says, "Yeah." He says, "Well, you keep doing what you're doing, because someday you will find that it'll be extremely helpful. And, you know, you don't have anybody, you're all alone, nobody's paying any attention, but it won't always be like that, believe me." He told me that. So I said, "Oh, who am I to say this beautiful spirit is wrong?" Because I could tell that they were speaking from direct seeing. So he saw that in the future I'll have responsibilities and there'll be people, I'll be helping a lot of people for sure. And so that helped a lot. That helped a lot for someone, a teacher like that, to say that to me. And who better to say that? Really, who better to say that? Because there's nobody that's being followed in recent times more than Ramana Maharshi in terms of real spiritual focus. No, he's the top one as far as offshoots from him and so many people, non-duality, Advaita Vedanta, and self-inquiry, and who am I? All this Neo-Vedanta, all this stuff comes from Ramana Maharshi. So he's tremendously influential. So for him to come to say, "Hey, what you're doing will someday, you know, have the same kind of influence. It'll be super good too." So I'm sure of that. So don't give up. I said, "Wow, that's a very helpful thing to say." So I guess it's very appropriate for him to say that. And this relates to the upcoming times when so many people will bottom out. There'll be a lot of aspirants on the path. There'll be a lot of people who realize that they can get bliss. They realize it. And then at that point, the teaching will kick in. People will realize, "Hey, this one is competent. This one knows what they're talking about. And so they can help me." Whereas right now, people are still thinking, "I don't think I can get it. I think I might be incompetent. I'm not sure. I got this nagging fear that I may be incompetent to reach the highest level." Well, there's really, there are no levels at all. It's just bliss. Bliss is doesn't have levels within it. But the fear of incompetence makes us see everything as stratified with levels. Think, well, I can get this high, but not that high, you know. It,